Tonight, dare to be like Daniel. John has been talking to us about the nature and the content of this class for some time. We're all really excited about it. And the premises that we're going to be talking about how Daniel and his peers handled living in a very secular society as we do today. And one of the things that has been a bit of a concern for John is that John's very capable of controlling himself and making sure that he is as sensitive as he can be to some of these emotionally charged issues that maybe that we are going to be visiting. And so I don't want to say anything that is designed or going to cause anybody to be discouraged from participating in class. And it's almost impossible to say this without actually doing that, but please understand it is not our intent. But we do want to suggest that that we be very cautious about being sensitive to the nature of these issues, that they are very emotionally charged. There are lots of really hard feelings on all sides of the issues in society, and we don't want to put a target on our back unnecessarily because we are live streaming these classes and recording them. The elders and John and I expect many of us here would be absolutely fine with having to deal with issues publicly as long as it's about doctrine and about the Word of God, but that doesn't mean we want to be insensitive to other people and how they feel about some of these sorts of things. So just be very careful and think about some of the things that you might have to say, because it's going out over the live stream. All right, does anybody have any questions about that, or do you want to add anything? Okay, John, did I do that okay? All right, let's go to God in prayer before we begin. Our great God in heaven, we're thankful for life and the blessings. We're thankful for this an opportunity to depart and separate ourselves from our normal lives and to come and worship with those who have like faith and study from your word. We pray, Father, that this hour will be beneficial to all who are here, that we will be encouraged and that we will be better prepared to be your servants. And of course, Father, we pray in all things that your name will be glorified by the things that we do. We ask, Father, that you be with us, that you bless us as you see fit. May we use these things in your service and to your glory. Please, dear Father, forgive us of our sins. We're so thankful that you loved us so much that you gave us your Son. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray these things. Amen.
If you have your Bibles with you and would like to follow, it ironed out. Let me explain to you why we have this up here. First of all, it allows me to advance slides if I'm using slides. I won't be using slides in every class. But also, this allows me to have show and tell in an auditorium class. And so I do have some things that I'll be showing. And so whatever I put down here, the camera will project up there, which is kind of neat. And I'd asked the elders if there was some way to do it, and they were able to get that accomplished. I'm very, very thankful for that. You know, one of the challenges of full-time preaching is that your time gets very fragmented. I guess that's a good way to say it. You're kind of a one-man show in a way. You know, you're working on sermons, and you're working on classes, and you're working on bulletins, and you're working on funerals, and you're working on weddings, and you get pulled in a lot of different directions. And oftentimes you don't have the time to concentrate on a particular subject that may be of special interest to you. And one of the great blessings of stepping down from full-time preaching is it has allowed me to concentrate on two areas that are very interesting to me and I think necessary for all of us. One area is what we're addressing in our Sunday morning class, the Faith Builder class, where we talk about evidences, Christian apologetics, why we believe what we believe. What is the evidence that there is a God? How do we know that the Bible is the inspired word of God? How do we know that Jesus is the Son of God? Is there good, rational, verifiable evidence for those things? So Christian apologetics and evidences just to increase our faith. And there has been an explosion in the last 10 years, I would say, of good material on that subject. In fact, I was reading some today, and I was saying to myself, I've got to teach that to them. I've got to teach that to them. And they're just, the frustration is I can't get it all said when I'm in that class, but boy, there is some exciting material to present. But then the other area that I think is very important for us is what we're going to start talking about this evening, and that is how the Bible relates to, I guess you would say, current events. You know, what we experience, the special challenges that we experience today. Some of the major issues that we're going through at this time. I believe with all of my heart that the two watershed moral issues of our day would have to be sexuality in all of its forms, and so sexual identity, gender identity, that sort of thing, homosexuality, those questions. So that would be one area, and then the other area would be life. When does life begin? When does life end? Questions regarding abortion and bioethics and stem cell research and some of those issues. And, of course, we're facing those issues. I don't think I'm telling you anything you don't know, in an increasingly secular society. You know, some things that it used to be common for just about everybody to believe, you know, even if they weren't real religious, at least they sort of believe some bedrock moral things, that day is past. In fact, it's hard for me to imagine just how far we have drifted just in my lifetime, just in a generation of time. And so those questions, those issues, I think, are on the forefront of our minds. We deal with those things. How do you handle those things in the workplace? How do you handle those things at school? What do you say? What do you not say? What's the best way to say it? And how do you address those things in a Bible-based way? That is a special challenge for us, I think. I think that's a special challenge for us. And the best book I know to help us promote our thinking along those lines is the book of Daniel. Because Daniel and his close friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they lived and served in two very secular societies. Now, I don't mean that the Babylonians didn't have religion. They certainly did, but they were very idolatrous, and the Medo-Persians as well. And overall, they were very secular in their worldview. So if you think about it, Daniel and his three friends had to wrestle with some of the same problems, challenges that we face, and yet who can doubt that they were very successful and God really blessed them under what must have been excruciating times. And so I just don't know a better place to go in the Bible than going to the book of Daniel. And I was trying to figure out a good way to introduce our thoughts this evening, try to get us to kind of prompt our thinking a little bit. So I'm going to ask the folks here, and I'm kind of scanning around the auditorium, and we've got a wide range of ages here this evening, but I'm going to ask everybody here to think about when you were 16 years old, so you're about a sophomore in high school, wouldn't that be about right? About a sophomore in high school, being 16 years old, look back at yourself at that time, and I want you to think of one word that you would have used to describe yourself. Looking back at your 16-year-old self, how would you now, and looking back, describe yourself in one word? Now, some of y'all, 16 was not all that long ago. For others of us, it was nearly 50 years ago, or over 50 years ago. And so you're really having to go back in your thinking. But looking back at 16, Frank's shaking his head no. Is it a bad memory, Frank, or what's the deal there? Oh, what's that now? Too many years ago. All right, and you have to think of the one word you would use to describe yourself. Is anybody dare brave enough to volunteer an answer for me? Daniel?
Naive.
That's a good one, naive. All right, yeah, now looking back, you realize how much you didn't know when you were 16. Now, when I was 16, I thought I was a pretty smart fellow. But now looking back on it, I just see I was dumb as a box of rocks, you know, but that's looking back on it now. Who else has one word that they would use?
Immature.
Okay, who said that? Doug, did you say that? Yeah, I saw you. I heard you there. immature. Do you know, Doug, that was the word I had for myself, too, is looking back, immature. I mean, oh, man, oh, how did I ever live to be an adult? You know, how did I make it through? Immature is the word that I'm thinking of. Paula?
Happy.
Now see, we're being all negative and down and everything. And Paula's going, man, I wish I had that year back. I would if I was, if I could have 64 years of wisdom, I wish I could get it back. Yeah.
You might have to know more than there is.
Did you know that Daniel was somewhere between 80 and 90 when he was cast into the lion's den? From age 16 to age, let's say, 85, he remained faithful all of that time. That's quite a testimony, isn't it? Quite a testimony. Jim?
There's two things. First of all, it's remarkable. His faith and his spirituality are remarkable. When you read the account from Ezekiel of the spiritual situation of Jerusalem, where he lived and where he was grown, where he grew up to that age.
Yes.
Because they didn't follow God.
Yes.
You talk about the other two being secular societies, Jerusalem, although it nominally said they followed God, they were a secular society too. Plus the fact at 16 he was taken away from everything and made a eunuch.
Yes. Now, I want to pose something to you here. Because that word eunuch is used, and probably as Jim was suggesting there, I immediately have one thought in my mind. I'm thinking about a male who's castrated. I'm thinking about a male who has that operation performed on him. One thing you need to be aware of is in Daniel's time, in the Old Testament, at this particular time, the word eunuch sometimes was used just to designate a member of nobility. And so it's possible, some scholars suggest, that he came from a noble kind of family back in Jerusalem. I don't know how long I would camp on that. I just throw that out in case you hadn't ever heard that. You may encounter it at some point. But it must have been regardless of that point. I mean, can you imagine the challenges of being pulled up out of your homeland, away from family and friends? And before the Babylonians became world empire, what was the world empire before that? Assyrians, that's exactly right. So remember that Assyria had taken the northern kingdom of Israel in captivity in 722 B.C. 722 B.C., Assyria had been carried Israel off into captivity. And you would think that Judah would learn a lesson. You know, that, well, look what God did when they weren't faithful. You know, so we're going to be faithful. We're going to repent. We're going to be faithful. But they didn't learn the lesson. And in 586 B.C., then Babylon carries a lot of the Jews away into captivity as well. So that's kind of the year that that's marked from. And Jim hit on something that's important. It's important to remember that Daniel and Ezekiel and Jeremiah are pretty much contemporaries with one another. Yeah, that's exactly right. And so Daniel, Ezekiel, and Jeremiah, though they prophesied in very different circumstances. So, for example, Daniel is in the capital city of Babylon. Ezekiel is in the surrounding country around Babylon, in Babylonia, the surrounding country. And where is Jeremiah? He's back in Jerusalem, all right? But you have to remember that those three prophets were contemporaries with one another. So it's very, when I think about that, and I think about 16-year-old John Evans, and then I start reading in the book of Daniel, I think to myself, boy, I would not have had the maturity of faith that he shows there. I think that would have been very hard. And then when I see that with the lion's den, you know, he's 85, maybe close to 90 years old. Not only was he faithful when he was 16, but he was faithful when he was an old man. And not only that, but he was faithful under two different regimes. You know, he starts out under the kingdom of Babylon, but then later on, what do we have? The kingdom of the Medes and the Persians, the Medo-Persian Empire. And God blessed him through all of that. If I ask you to identify the theme in the book of Daniel, what theme would come to your mind? If I just said in one sentence, give me the theme of the over. And Daniel's very interesting. The way it's written, the first six chapters, even kids enjoy reading the first six chapters. It's easy, it's a narrative, easy to follow. Last six chapters are some of the hardest chapters in all of the Bible. Very, very unusual to have that dichotomy like that. But what would you say is the overall theme of the book of Daniel?
Trust in God.
Okay, now that's good. I think I could live with that one pretty easily. Trust in God. That's certainly an important lesson. Because God knows how to bless them even under difficult circumstances. John?
God has a plan.
Yeah, that's good. And you're kind of going down the pathway I was thinking about. I was thinking about something like that God is the ultimate ruler in the kingdoms of men. You know, because you see that continually, don't you? That goes along with trusting God. That goes along with God has a plan. But God rules in the kingdoms of men. Do y'all think we need that message in 2023? In San Antonio, Texas, who's ultimately in control? God is ultimately in control.
Help if more people believe it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And so God's ultimately in control, but the fact that God is ultimately in control doesn't deny individuals the opportunity to make choices. Now, that's something that's hard for me to grapple with. I can't say that I fully understand that. God's ultimately in control, but I also know that the Bible shows that we can make choices in this life. We have the ability to make a decision, to make a choice in this life. So God is ultimately in control, and he can use both the evil of men and the good that men do in order to accomplish his will. But his will is going to be accomplished. There's no doubt about that. All right, so let's do just a little bit of reading then, if we can. Let's go ahead and pick up here in the book of Daniel. And I'm told that the microphones will pick up reading out in the auditorium. And so, I like having other folks read for me a little bit. And so, Daniel, would you start us out, since we're in Daniel, get Daniel to start us out here and read the first four verses for me, please. First four verses.
In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it.
You know, I find Nebuchadnezzar, I didn't let you read very much, did I? I find Nebuchadnezzar a very interesting character, because on one hand, he seems to be kind of a religiously minded fella. You know, he does have respect for a god, some god. He does have a religious bent about him. And yet he also does some really horrible things. Now, he's a very complex character. By the way, how long did the kingdom of Babylon exist? Anybody do any research on that? You ever thought about that? The entire kingdom of Babylon, how long did it exist? The answer is not all that long, about 100 years. So the Neo-Babylonian Empire, this empire we're thinking about right here, actually only existed for about 100 years, which is kind of interesting, I think. Go ahead, Dan.
The Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasury of his God.
All right. I find that interesting in verse 2 when it says, who gave Jehoiakim into Nebuchadnezzar's hand? The Lord did. Why? Why would the Lord allow the king of Judah to be carried away into Babylonian captivity, or to be defeated by the Babylonians? What do you think? What do you think, John?
Was it the rule of his wrath?
Yes. So it's punishment.
The rod of my anger.
Yeah. So it's punishment for their infidelity, for their rebellion against God. Now, again, you know, to me, that's a really important lesson for 2023, or for any time, that God knows how to punish the nations of men who rebel against him. And he does it in his time, and he does it in his way. But it's important to remember that. God ultimately is in control. Go ahead.
Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, the chief of his officials, to bring in some of the sons of Israel, including some of the royal family, and of the nobles, youths in whom was no defect, who were good-looking, showing intelligence, and every branch of wisdom, endowed with understanding and discerning knowledge, and who had ability for serving in the king's court. And he ordered him to teach them the literature and language of the Chaldeans.
Did a little study on this, and by the way, Chaldeans is oftentimes used as a synonym for Babylonians. Did a little study on this practice of Nebuchadnezzar, and he thought when he conquered a nation that a good way to integrate them into Babylonian society was to do what he just did here. He would take some of the nobles, some of the children, some of the youths, the folks who showed extra promise, and he would sort of educate them into the Babylonian culture. He thought that was a way to sort of integrate this new nation. So, you know, and that's a pretty wise thing to do. He strikes me as a very intelligent person. He could be very bloodthirsty. He was very idolatrous, but his heart also could be turned to God. He's a very complex character, but a very mighty king and very interesting to study. Go ahead.
The king appointed for them a daily ration from the king's choice food and from the wine which he drank, and appointed that they should be educated 3 years, at the end of which they were to enter the king's personal service. Now among them, from the sons of Judah, were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Then the commander of the officials assigned new names. Daniel, he assigned the name Belshazzar to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego.
I'm just going to call them Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from this time on. That's easier for me to say. But so he gives them to the chief of the eunuchs. He gave them these new names. That's something that he had the power to do. And he's getting ready to feed them with the king's food. And I'm thinking, well, you know, if you were a teenager, how much did you eat when you were 16 years old, Daniel? And bear in mind that I've been around Lassiter's for a long time.
Right? Not as much as John.
Okay. Not me. He meant his brother.
My brother, John.
Yeah. But John would show up to our door, and my mom would go, I didn't make enough chicken. I didn't. But anyway, so here's the king's delicacies, and the last thing that a 16-year-old normally is going to turn down is great food, right? I mean, really, seriously, that's the last thing they're going to turn down. But he has such a strength of character that says he's not going to defile himself with the king's food. Doesn't tell us exactly how he would defile himself. I think there are a couple of possibilities. It's possible that some of the food was offered to idols, so that might be, or it could just be that it violated the dietary restriction of the Jews. And so there if food that was forbidden for them to eat. But to be 16 years old and to stick with that when your friends, you know, you got three buddies there, but the rest of your family and everybody's not around, that shows a strength of character that I think very few 16-year-olds would be willing to show.
Raw red meat that Ryan passed on.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. None of that really appealed to me too much. But anyway, we live in a very, let's pause for a second in our reading. We live in a very secular society, and we see and hear things now that when I was a youngster would have just been so shocking. I tell folks, I'm no longer surprised, but I am disappointed. I am disappointed. And so here's a billboard. What do y'all think about that? In the beginning, man created God. There's probably no God. Now stop worrying and enjoy your life. You think that's an attitude a lot of folks have nowadays? I think so. Sadly, more folks are adopting that attitude. And to me, that's very disappointing. That's very disturbing to see something like that. Right? And then, just talking about some of these, the secular nature, the society in which we live, this is a quotation from Steven Weinberg. He's passed away now, but he was a big deal in science, a Nobel laureate physicist, and he was speaking at a science conference in La Jolla, California in 1994, and he said, anything that we scientists can do to weaken the hold of religion should be done and may, in fact, in the end, be our greatest contribution to civilization. How does that strike y'all? Terrible. I mean, terrible. I mean, even if you thought that, why would you say that to a group of people? But evidently, he was comfortable enough in the setting in which he was, thinking that a lot of folks would agree with him, that he felt comfortable saying that. Is that as disturbing to y'all as it is to me? That's very disappointing, very disturbing. And again, here's somebody with a lot of influence. Here's somebody who had a reputation. Here's somebody that would be invited to a lot of conferences. And he says, look at him, again, of all the things that a scientist could do, you know, anything we can do to weaken the hold of religion may end up being our greatest contribution to civilization. Be better than wiping out cancer. Be better. Can you imagine even thinking that? Isn't that a terrible idea? It's a terrible thing. But it does tell you where at least some people are in their thinking. All right? Richard Dawkins is a very famous atheist. But he says this. He says, I think that the case can be made that faith is one of the world's great evils, comparable to the smallpox virus. You talk about, I mean, how do you respond to something like that? If you're like I am, I start getting angry whenever I see that. You know, you got to kind of watch yourself and remember that not everybody thinks that way, not everybody believes that way. But it's harder to eradicate. So it's like smallpox, but it's harder to get rid of. Faith, and now this is very revealing. He says, faith, being belief that isn't based on evidence, Would we agree with that statement? Absolutely not. I think there is good evidence for what we believe. Faith, being belief that isn't based on evidence, is the principal vice of any religion. Right? Now again, that just shows you where at least some people are in their thinking. One of the things that I've learned in our class in the back there, the Faith Builder class, is brothers and sisters, there is overwhelming evidence. There is convincing evidence. There is superior evidence to show you that there is a God, that the God of the Bible is the God of the universe. It is evidence-based. And I just think that the evidence is compelling and overwhelming. And I think one of the devil's favorite tools, if I can say it this way, is just to suppress the evidence. The problem is most folks don't know the evidence. They haven't studied the evidence, or they think like Richard Dawkins that faith means there is no evidence. It's just a blind belief, just a blind trust. But those are, if I read too many of these, I'll start getting upset, so I better not do that. I better not show this one either. Peter Singer, professor of bioethics, this is disturbing, professor of bioethics at Princeton University, was speaking about severely mentally handicapped people. And he said, their lives have no intrinsic value. Now, he's teaching bioethics. Their lives have no intrinsic value. They are biologically alive. No, their heart's beating, but not biographically. They're not really there. They're not in the location. So, yeah, their heart's beating, but biographically, they're not really a person. He stated that they were, therefore, candidates for euthanasia. How would you respond? I mean, how would you begin to address that? And obviously, I chose some of the strongest quotations just to try to make my point. But I don't think anybody here this evening would doubt that we do live in a very secular society, and it's becoming more secular as time marches along. And as Christians, we have our work cut out for us. We certainly have work that we need to do. But it shows at least where some people are in their thinking. All right? And that's led, then, to what Nancy Percy, who's an author and a really good writer, what she calls a great divide. She says, in our culture, we have come to a point where there is a great cultural divide when people think about science and religion. Now, we're going to delve into that in just a little more detail in just a moment. But let's add just a few more verses to our reading here. So we're going to pick up in verse 8, and who would like to read for me this evening? Who would be willing to read for me? Judy, you fill up to read? Okay.
But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself.
Boy, that verse 8 is a key verse. Daniel did what? He purposed in his heart. Now, how would we say that in our own language? What, serving God begins with what? Yeah, a decision. You purpose in your heart. You make a decision that there is a no matter what in my life. No matter what, I'm going to serve God. So here's a 16-year-old youth in a foreign country, away from family, who has all of this spread of food.
So he sought to say, here's what I want to do, here's what I've going to do, but I don't want to do it in a disrespectful manner.
Now, that is a key point, and John, you've hit on something I wanted to emphasize this evening and in lessons to come. There's no doubt that Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were willing to stand for the truth. You can't read about their lives and say anything different than that. But they did not look to be confrontational in the way they did it or to act in a disrespectful way. And so, you know, like Ephesians, Paul, you know, talks about speaking the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love. You know, we're bound by the truth, but there's a way to do it. You know, and as you said, he wasn't disrespectful to him. He made up his mind what he was going to do, but he sought permission and gave a reasonable test in order to do it. And I think that is so key because, again, when we start talking about some of the controversial issues that we're going to be talking about this in the coming weeks, we start talking about those things, it's easy to get upset. It's easy to get riled up. You know, it's easy to say things out of turn. You know, that's just natural human reaction when you get really emotionally involved in something. But it doesn't look like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did that. They were able to contain themselves while still standing for the truth. And I think that's one of the powerful lessons in the book of Daniel. All right. So, keep on for us, Judy.
Now, God had brought Daniel into the favor and goodwill of the chief of eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who has appointed your food and drink. For why should he see your faces looking worse than the young men who are your age? And you would endanger my head before the king.
All right, very interesting. He says, now let me see. You eat celery and tomatoes, and you're not going to look too fleshy at the end of his time, you know. And he said that I'm supposed to be feeding you. And so here we have all this nice spread, and you want to just eat over here and eat these things that aren't nearly as delicious and don't have as many calories and everything. And so I can see him saying that. I can see him saying that. And I've often wondered if what Daniel and them did, if they looked better just because their diet was more healthy during those 10 days. But it occurs to me that even if they were real healthy, they wouldn't have put on weight, you know, eating what they ate. So it makes me think that God intervened in order for them to look the way they did. But he had made his mind up that he wasn't going to defile himself. He did it in a respectful way. He asked permission, and then God blesses him in the process. Now, to me, that's a really important lesson. Well, we don't take anything else, you know, home with us tonight. We can take that with us. So standing for the truth, but standing for the truth in the right way, being respectful. That's a key lesson, and it's hard for us to do. Now, I want to talk for just a little bit more about this great divide. So Nancy Percy talks about this great divide in our culture. All right, so here's the way a large part of our culture looks at things. So facts are universal. Everybody should agree on facts. Facts are universal. But values and morality, you know, what you think's right, Reagan, what I think is moral, that's going to vary from person to person. And those things are individual. So facts are universal. Values and morality are individual. Stay with me here on the thinking. The brain up here, the thinking part, that's where science belongs. That's the realm of science. But the heart, your emotions, that's where religion belongs. So religion belongs in your heart. Science belongs in your brain. You see, we're starting to go down kind of a dangerous pathway here. Just stay with me on the thinking here. Think about the secular realm. So out here in the world, that's where science and politics and economics and legal issues, you know, that's where those things belong, is in the world discussion. So when we're out here in the world, and it's okay, you know, most politicians are savvy enough to where they would not attack religion directly. They just wouldn't do that, not most politicians. But what they'll say is something along the lines of, it's okay for you to have faith as long as what? Oh, you kind of keep that to yourself. The religious realm, family, church, worship, personal morality, that's the religious realm. And that kind of belongs in the private setting. All right? Now just stay with me on the thinking here. Science is based on facts and evidence. Now understand, this is not what I think. This is the cultural divide.
Religion is based on feelings and emotions. Where you feel about something, your emotions, that's a religion. Right? Science is rational and verifiable. But religion and morality are relative. Don't you be telling me what's right or what's wrong. You know, if you feel that way, that's fine. You can feel that way. But that's going to vary from person to person. And morality is not objective truth. That's the way a lot of folks see it. Science belongs in the public sphere. Religion is something you should sort of keep to yourself. It's okay for you to have it, but you need to kind of keep it to yourself. Science is total truth. Science is total truth. Well, we've had a lot of discussion here in the last 3 years, haven't we, about science, what's not science. I'm not going to go down that pathway. Just realize that a lot of folks would say science is total truth. Religion is some truth maybe. Right? So what are the consequences of that thinking, that great cultural, social divide? What are the consequences of that?
Essentially, the deification of man's knowledge of the physical world.
Yes, that's right. A man is going to have some kind of God. I always say that. It may be the God of the Bible, or it may be somebody else's God. But it elevates man's knowledge above his religious faith, or separates
man's knowledge about part of it.
Yes, that's right. That's a good way to say it. Judy, is that for you?
Division in families, in
yes.
Governments.
Yes.
Social?
Right. Yeah, keep saying it. You're exactly right. It certainly leads to a fracturing of society. Well, at least that's not happening now. Any other consequences? Dan?
Like the total demolition of faith. I mean, all religion is a mess. It's everywhere.
Okay.
There's not one faith.
All right. Yes. Regardless of what you believe, you can find somebody who will support you in that belief. All right, yes, Lynn?
Jesus said a house divided cannot stand.
Yes.
I would say it reads the consequences of chaos.
Chaos.
And it represents all kinds of things.
But would y'all agree that to a large extent we see this division that we're talking about? Did I see a hand over here? Yes.
Hierarchy.
Oh, hierarchy. Explain that a little bit for me.
You've got the elite.
Okay.
There's elite in science.
Science is
yeah.
Elite.
And you've got us lower individuals.
Okay, so those who have faith, they're a little slower, not quite with it, kind of thing. Yeah, yes, certainly that can happen. That can be the idea. Mike?
How does somebody, say, scientifically identify as somebody else or something else? I identify as this, okay, whatever it is. I feel that way. But then it's science. You follow what I'm saying?
I do. I don't think I can answer that tonight, but I do want you to know, Mike, that I identify as a 20-year-old marathon runner. What do y'all have?
Well, but scientifically, what I'm getting at is that I think they're straddling the idea of science being, you want this divide, but at the same time, you want to appeal to feelings or how you feel, which are supposed to be in the category of a spiritual religious.
And that's what we're going to be talking about.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you're doing a good job of highlighting the problem. So if, Mike, we express a position on matters of morality, like marriage, homosexuality, gender identity, abortion, bioethics, we think we're stating objective moral truth. We think we are stating objective moral truth. The world thinks that we're stating what?
Our opinion.
That's exactly right, man. Our opinion, our personal preference. Keep your opinions and your personal preferences and non-objective truth to yourself. And here is Daniel. What that's where we're going to